Welcome to Lecture 13 on Napoleon. We ended last time with the Reign of Terror giving way to the more relaxed rule of the French Directory. Today we will see how Napoleon emerged out of this period to lead France in yet another direction. Let's begin with Napoleon's early years. Napoleon was born in 1769, a child of a poor but noble family from Corsica, a little island nestled in the Mediterranean between the Italian peninsula and the south of France. Corsica at the time was culturally and linguistically an Italian area, but the territory was owned by France. So when he came of age, being a younger son, his family sent him to be trained in the armies of the old regime, and he was commissioned there in 1785. So this is just a few years before the Revolution. When the French Revolution broke out, he favored it, and he remained in the army, and it was not that long after that he came to public notice. It was during the Terror, in fact. His first military success came when he triumphantly defended Toulon, a city in the south of France, from British invasion in 1793. And that then led to his coming to public attention during the Directory, and he soon became one of the most successful generals in the French army. He probably had his eye on ruling France already by the mid-1790s, but he bided his time and he waited to see what would happen and to see what kind of chances might offer themselves. In 1798, his first major opportunity occurred. He was tapped to lead a mystery naval expedition, but it wasn't said where it would be. He was given a whole fleet of ships, and he was given money to basically command anyone he wanted to come with him. And he ordered all sorts of doctors and scientists and artists and writers, in addition to the usual naval and army men and supplies. But he didn't tell anybody where they were going. And a lot of people thought that it was clearly an invasion that was being planned. And a lot of people guessed that the plan was to invade England. But in fact, the goal was to go to Egypt. And the plan was to lead a naval invasion of Egypt in a direct race against the British, who were also very interested in Egypt. Now you might ask, why Egypt? Well, it was, for one thing, the breadbasket of the Ottoman Empire and North Africa. And Egypt also held the potential that people were already well aware of in the 1780s and 90s of holding the key to an overland route to India. So Napoleon takes his fleet across the Mediterranean towards Egypt. It was very exciting. At first, the British didn't know where they were going, but they figured it out pretty quickly. And they chased Napoleon's fleet. And the crazy thing is that the British actually landed at Alexandria, the Egyptian port, where they guessed Napoleon would be. But they were so fast that Napoleon's fleet actually hadn't arrived yet, and the Brits sailed on. And then the French arrived, and they began the invasion process. And the next great thing that I'll mention is documented in this painting. This is Watteau's Battle of the Pyramids, where Napoleon and his forces defeated the Egyptian army on July 21st, 1798. But while Napoleon was victorious on land, he lost at sea. And this shows another very famous battle, the Battle of the Nile, also known as the Battle of Aboukir Bay, where Horatio Nelson and the British fleet destroyed the French fleet on August 1st. Be that as it may, the French did successfully invade Egypt, and they conquered it, and they remained there for several years. And Napoleon he put himself in charge of the Egyptian government after they had stolen it from the Ottomans. But in 1799, Napoleon was secretly called back to Paris from Cairo. And this painting that was made about a decade later represents that calling. This is the allegory of the state of France before the return from Egypt. And here we see these lovely nymphs representing France in a state of need, and Napoleon shown here in Egypt, as you can see from the pyramids, and they're longing for him to return. And why did they want him to come back? Because there was a plan for a political coup in which Napoleon and two other men would take power from the Directory. When this happened on November 9th, Napoleon got himself named as first consul, first among equals, following the Roman Republican pattern from the ancient world. And this is how Napoleon's rule in France begins. And the period, the first period of his rule, we call the consulate, from 1799 to 1804. As first consul, Napoleon did several important things. The most important of these was he instituted a new constitution, and this was the second constitution of the French Republic. It appealed to Republican theory by including a safety net of checks and balances. It included a council of state, and it actually made Napoleon ruler, effectively. In 1802, he went to the people to be named consul for life. This move was approved by a plebiscite, or a direct vote by the people, rather than by deputies. So you know how in the United States, we don't actually directly elect the president. We elect representatives to the Electoral College, and they choose the president. Well, the same sort of thing happened normally in France, only Napoleon bypassed that route to go directly to the people. And this is the vote he got. He got 3.5 million yes votes, as opposed to 8,000 no votes. It's pretty evident this was a very rigged election, and may justly be regarded as the end of the French Revolution. Napoleon, as consul, maintained order in the state through a combination of liberal and conservative gestures. His liberal policies involved working out important compromises between competing groups. These were chiefly the peasants, the nobility, and the middle classes, or bourgeoisie. The gains that the peasants had made during the terror, sorry, not the terror, during the great fear of the summer of 1789 were confirmed. They were confirmed as landowners and guaranteed freedom from feudalism. The nobility, which had been decimated by the French Revolution, and many aristocrats had fled, had gone into exile, had left France, the nobility was granted amnesty so that exiles could return in safety and come back to reclaim their property and their titles. And thirdly, he instituted a national form of education. And this improved education, which aimed to elevate everybody socially, was especially appealing to the middle classes, the bourgeoisie. Napoleon also worked to maintain a very conservative order. He ended all free speech and he stopped the free press in 1800. He was absolutely ruthless in crushing any and all political opposition to his goals. And to that end, he stopped free elections. And he did, elections were no more possible once he had declared himself emperor. And this is the next phase of his rule in France, the empire. Napoleon used fears, he was very clever, he used popular fears of a royal Bourbon comeback, that's the name of the royal family, in order to get himself crowned emperor in 1804. As justification for calling himself emperor, Napoleon compared himself to Charlemagne, France's legendary historical emperor. Charlemagne, over 1,000 years ago, almost exactly 1,000 years ago, in 800 AD, had been crowned the first Holy Roman Emperor by the Pope. In fact, Charlemagne was supposedly crowned against his will by the Pope 1,000 years before Napoleon. In memory of that, and to make a connection to himself, Napoleon, when he decided to become emperor, he invited the Pope to France, but then crowned himself rather than letting the Pope crown him, so that Napoleon could symbolize that his authority was supreme, meaning that not even the Pope was above him. And this very famous painting, shown here in detail by David, of Napoleon crowning the Empress Josephine, this painting is interesting for a number of reasons, one of which is that David, the painter, was actually embarrassed to show Napoleon crowning himself. He thought it was a rather shameful act. So instead, he chose to depict the next event, which was Napoleon crowning his wife Josephine. Once Napoleon had become emperor, he instituted his other major piece of legislation after having created the second constitution in a couple years earlier. In 1804, he had jurists draft a new law code called the Civil Code, or Code Civil, also known as the Napoleonic Code. The Civil Code contained another of important ideas. It guaranteed the safety of all property rights, which appealed to liberal philosophy. It abolished all privileges of birth, institutionalizing the end of feudalism. It also determined that state officials would henceforth be chosen by merit, adhering to the 17th century principles of John Locke. And it also had a gender dimension. Men were given complete legal control over their wives. Napoleon's policies would set the tone for all later French life. From here on, through the 19th and well into the 20th century, really even to today, France would be essentially legally egalitarian, socially bourgeois, and administratively bureaucratic.